We've seen some familiar faces. How many folks have been here before doing this?
Been to the winery, but not on the tour.
Not on the tour. No. How many guys have gone on the vineyard walk before? Okay, half of you. So there's going to be some repeat. You can only make up so much. The property's about 100 acres. It's actually four parcels. A lot of family farms are like that. They're not one big parcel. They're many different parcels brought together under one fence line. The Kohlers bought this place in 96 from the previous owner. It was a guy named Doug Kramer. He was a producer for Aaron Spelling. I did Love Boat, and I think he did Dynasty, Wonder Woman, all the 70s and 80s hits. So he built the main house down the road. This was the old farmhouse. This is something we rent out for the next year, possibly, because the county has now made short-term rentals illegal. About 64 acres in grapes. It was originally planted in 72, and like I was telling so many folks, they planted what was popular in 72. So Cabernet, Riesling, Chenin, Chardonnay. Some of that remains, and then much of it has been grafted over to Rhone varieties in the last 25 years, which do really well in this little Fox and Canyon corridor. So Grenache, Syrah, Mourvedre, Viognier, and Grenache Blanc. So we still have what I call the heritage varieties. 45-year-old Riesling is really cool. If we pulled that out, it can't be replaced. That's the oldest Riesling in the county. Firestone has a few rows that were planted the same day. And that's how this area was planted, right here on this road. The truck would show up with Cabernet vines and the little grafted to their rootstock. And this crew would go there, another crew would go here, another crew would go up the road. It was all planted on the same day. The next day, the Riesling would show up. Firestone would get planted with one crew, we'd get planted with the other crew, and then down. So it's funny to hear people make claims of first. It was all the same vineyard company. But it is interesting. I can go over, if I see a problem with some of our Riesling, I'll go over and talk to the guys and check out their Riesling. I know it's exactly the same
stuff. You guys talk to each other?
Oh yeah, all the time. Yeah, you're not going to drink one wine. You know, there's lots of room on the table for many different labels, so there's less, not really a competition, so to speak. Or if there is, it's healthy and amicable. let's see. Oh, and we do have some Chardonnay. Clone 4, which is a nice workhorse clone for this area. Obviously, we're not as cool as Santa Rita Hills, but not quite as warm as Happy Canyon. So the Clone 4 really thrives in this area. Something like the Dijon clones, 76 and 96, really wouldn't fare too well here. In fact, I don't think they do too well in Santa Rita Hills either. They get flabby very fast. The acid, you lose the acid. So it looks like, I think this is as many as we're going to get for the time being. So if you follow me, what we're going to do is we're going to walk down the road and down the driveway. I don't know if you can see that mule down there, but head towards the creek. I'm going to observe the Mourvedre being pre-pruned with our pre-pruner that's on the front of the tractor, and then the guys are going to demonstrate some pruning techniques. And then you guys can pepper me with any questions. Follow me? Oh, my name's Colin, by the way.
Hi, Colin.
The idea is to make small cuts. You would make a big cut to leave some dieback, and then the sap and the fluids and the moisture and the water can't flow as well. But we've left some what we call kickers. So typically we're pruning down about two buds, and that's going to where our new growth will be. And mostly 90% of your grapes are going to be on new growth. So that's the point of pruning it back. We're really not interested in growing a giant hedge. Grapevines are creepers, so they're going to, we're just training them up. But this is a kicker, so we've got more positions here, and that's just kind of an insurance policy. Later on, we can actually come in and put some. We want to kind of watch it for a while and maximize the yield, because it has been a little lower than we can pencil out in the last few years.
It's done by hand.
The pre-pruning is done by machine, which we'll see. And then, you can see it right there. This is a tractor. That's our New Holland, but it's got a frame, a universal frame that does on front. It's got a hydraulic booster in the back, even though that tractor probably doesn't need it. It's less strain on the hydraulic. And then in the front, it's got a series of discs on each side, and it just chops the cane that's going up here. And then the boys will come through with the they have electric shears. And then just clean it up. It's going to make a rough cut. And they'll come through and cut it to where we want it, like 2 or 3 bucks, about 3 bucks. And then a nice clean cut. You can see over here, this is about 25-year-old Cabernet that has not been pruned. It's not even dropped its leaves yet. You might even see a few green leaves popping up. Well, certainly in the Chardonnay, you can see some green leaves. Yeah, it's very premature. And if we were to get frost, that would all get fried. And the other problem is pests. With this warm weather, the pests aren't going anywhere. Mealybug, you know, typically we'll have 4 or 5 generations. We'll probably see 6 or 7 generations this year, which is a big problem. It's a very expensive treat. And it can kill your vineyard if you don't do it. There's other things we can do. We can put out pheromone traps, which actually confuse that whole cycle. I think we can probably wait for that. You would see the white fuzzy guys and it's wet, and we notice it because the bees are attracted to all the moisture weeping from the plant, and then all the ants kind of like aphids farm the little mealybugs. It used to be just a problem in Santa Maria, now it's all over the county. I used to work at Foley Estates, and much of the Chardonnay in front is below Highway 246. They went about 3 years without getting any fruits in that front 10 acres between mildew and frost. Well, we want to prune them before they start pushing out a lot of leaves, you know, that buds start expressing themselves. And it's tough because typically, like with the Morvedra, we usually do this last because we want it to push out last, because it ripens last. But, you know, we don't want it sprouting and suddenly we get a frost. We can get frost up until about May 1st. This year, I don't know. Who knows? Global weirding.
Does that that impacts the yield and the
taste? Not necessarily, but certainly it puts you in a danger zone, again, in terms of yield. Certainly, with the droughty, well, let's say out of 10 years, it's been droughty 7 or 8 of those years. We have a couple wells. We don't have a problem getting the water to the vines. However, these trees are accustomed to a big, fat creek full of water. So where are they going to get their water? They're going to pull it out of the vineyard. So all of these end plants have been suffering. No matter how many emitters we put on there, the trees are going to win. And then the pests are going to take advantage again with the stressed out vine on the end. So, and for some reason, the ground squirrels always love going after the end plants. They're the worst. We're trapping about, what, 20 a day?
Wow.
It's like painting the bridge, right? You start at one end, you get the other, and you just start all over again. There's no, you don't eradicate them. And we're just using the simple garden. Get in the way.
Oh.
We just haven't found out an effective way to get rid of them. You know, with cutting, pulling them out would be a pain. I thought about getting some jaws of life. It's amazing when you can buy a leaf. Well, you know, a sawzall really wouldn't work. You have to hold them steady. As you can, it's not moving particularly fast, about a mile and a half per hour. But it can make pretty cool work. Yeah, you can hear him hit the door. Because he has to physically open his stuff. They do make them off, you know, we can get that with an actual visual piece to it, where it opens and closes on matches. But again, with these stakes, it's not going to see them as well. And then you just end up dulling the
I don't know.
It's not perfect. It's a rough cut. You might miss a few canes. But when these guys come through, they don't have to pull those canes on. They typically don't have to show them how you would normally. Typically, it would take about 15 people 6 weeks to prune the entire meter. It's going to take one driver and then three of these guys about 3 weeks to prune the entire meter. And it's not just the cost of labor, but labor is very hard to come by these days. We are in negative territory in terms of immigration. Mexico. Mexico makes up 28% of all immigration. We are now at a net loss on immigration to Mexico. And even in terms of cost, it's not just the hourly wage. If you have less people, you're also talking about workers' comp and all the other costs. And then injuries are quite prevalent. Individuals where someone just twists their ankle or possibly dehydrated. Pinot vineyards are extremely dense to have close to 3,000. Well, you can see how fast he's getting through this. When he was doing it last year, we had one rig, and we had the two other guys doing the same thing. He was doing more than twice as much work.
What did you forget to do this morning?
Boss. What didn't I forget? Now what we're drinking, well, most of us are drinking, the rosé is 90% Grenache and then 10% Mourvèdre, which you get from here. When the timing is right, the Grenache and the Mourvèdre actually kind of ripening at the same time. We do pick for the rosé a little earlier, about 2 weeks before the red pick. I'm not looking for as high sugars, I'm looking for a little better acid. But it just depends on the season. With the 2017 harvest, there was no Mourvèdre in the rosé. The timing just wasn't right. So all these barrels are empty. They're barrels that I'm rinsing and conditioning. Some of them just gas and put away, some of them to use. Behind you, you have some puncheons. Those are 132 gallons, so that's about 500. I use those primarily for Grenache and Mourvèdre. It's a nice vessel because it's just a very nice surface to wine ratio. Those two varieties don't need much. The most they ever see is 10% new barrel. These are pretty standard size throughout the industry. Although you're going to see more these come and go. I pulled these. I didn't have these in service for about one harvest, and that's why I think we have a little bit of condition again. These are 60 gallons, 225 liters. And so this is the most common stallions. But they can make little tiny barrels, very, very large barrels, everything in between. Depends on one's philosophy. This is the crush pad, so this is where all the harvesting happens. And, you know, most of my winery is outside, so this is where it's going to happen. You can see these tanks behind you. What you hear is my compressor chiller, and I'm going to back it as well, but that is running glycol through the jackets, that nipple look is that glycol jacket, so it is, I can set the temperature and maintain that via during fermentation on a red if I want it at 75 degrees or for the white if it's at 55 degrees. Right now they're all chilling, most of them are chilling down about 29-30 degrees. The white's being cold stabilized. I'm preparing to find them where I will add a protein and some bentonite clay to clarify them and stabilize them in various ways, be it protein stabilization. When I'm done, I'll rack them clean into another tank. Bottling on 27. Until bottling.
And how many days, weeks?
Well, so when the white grapes come, they'll come in that plastic bin, that picking bin, half a ton, 1,000 pounds. I'll pick it up with my forklift, which has the bin dumper on front. It goes into that hopper, into my Euro press, and then I'll put about 5 tons in there. So 10 of those bins, whole cluster. And then over the course of 2.5-3 hours, it'll press all the juice off of it. So it'll start very low, put a little pressure on, back off, roll, break up the cake, a little higher pressure. It only goes up to about 2 bar. So 1 bar is about 14 psi, so not quite 30 psi is what it's all done. The juice goes into the pan. I pump the juice into one of these tanks overnight. All the junk, know, bugs and dirt, you know, all the sausage factory stuff you don't want to know about. It sits on the bottom, and I rack it clean into another tank. Then I will inoculate it with the yeast I want to use. It'll ferment over the course of about 10 days to 2 weeks at 55 degrees. I'll get nice and cool, so you're not blowing off a lot of estrogen. You walk in the wine and you smell those beautiful teeth and apple coffee. Those are just estrogens blowing off. The reds are a little different. They come in those bins, and then that hopper back there, should be less red, put on some weight estrogen. That hopper will feed it into a crusher destemmer. This is a box where you have paddles spinning one way on a rod, and then a basket spinning the other way. So it's going to knock the grapes off of the rakes if it hasn't been already done on that machine. Brings in just berries. In that case, I just dump it into one of those open top fermenters, chill it down, let it chill for about 3 days, what we call cold soak. What that does is allow the skins to start breaking down. That's where your color is going to come from. So it's not going to be any darker than it normally would, but you're going to ensure that it's as dark as it possibly be, or natural color. And then after about 3 days, I will add again the yeast that I've chosen, and then inoculate it with a punch down tool. That's just a piece of stainless with a foot. And I've got a scaffolding that goes on top or an old board. And I'll do a punch down. So I'll punch down the cap. There's all the skins and seeds. Well, basically, most of the skins get filled with that CO2 and form a hard cap on the top. We will punch those. I will punch them. There's no one else. Punch it down once a day. You may hear some wineries where they go, oh, we sleep there every 4 hours, we can punch down. That's too much. You're macerating that stuff, particularly Pinot Noir, you don't need more than one. Now, if it starts to get a little hot, stinky, what we call reduction, which is the production of H2S, hydrogen disulfide, kind of that match sticky party stuff. Little air will help blow that off, but it won't get too hot if I'm setting it for 75 degrees. Yeast do not like hot fermentation. There are plenty of guys that do it. There's an argument to be made for whether we can do the proteins and the texture of the wine. So maybe that should be done afterwards. But yeast above 75 degrees start getting leaky membranes. They can't take in nutrients as well, so they produce off aromas and off flavor.
Different yeast produce different results?
Within a very small range. I mean, what I'm looking for are the kinetic, the fermentation kinetics. Can it handle the alcohol, the potential alcohol? So based on the amount of sugar it has, I can extrapolate, I can say, okay, roughly 60% of the sugar, the conversion rate is about 60%. So if I'm picking at 24 bricks, I'll end up with about 14.4 alcohol by volume. So I need a yeast that can ferment to that level. If I pick a yeast that doesn't go that high, I'm going to end up with residual sugar. Sometimes I pick a yeast that will actually kill the other yeast, release enzymes, what they call a killer yeast. It's got to handle the pH that we're working at, the acid that we're working at. Have I added any SO2? Which I often will at the hopper or at the press. I'll add a little SO2. To protect that juice and wine while it goes and sits overnight or sits in the tank for 3 days cold soak. So when the reds are done, I will drain from the bottom valve into a screen, a pump, and then pump into another tank all the free run. That's just the stuff that's gushing out. The next day, in theory, it should be empty. The next day, I'll open up and it'll gush out again after everything's settled. That's when I scoop it out into that bin again with a shovel and then dump it into the hopper and then press off the remaining 25-30% that's left from the pumice. The whites, when they're done, chill them down and so they settle, all that yeast settles at the bottom nice and clean, dead yeast cell, and then through that racking valve, which is sort of about a foot above the bottom, I've got a racking arm with a sink glass. So start pulling wine off and then adjust this arm down until I get a little puff of yeast so I know I can pull all the wine off the top into another tank. And that's when my fining process starts. I usually do about 2 to 3 small findings with protein and clay. For clarification, it's a little bit. But it depends on the wine. They all get one. Most of them get two, and then one gets three. The rosé usually gets three, and the Viognier gets three. The Chardonnay, if it's been in barrel, usually gets three. The smaller ones, and then I can kind of decide whether I need to continue rather than be finding where I might overshoot. What I'm trying to do, or you don't want to strip the wine. Getting warm, let's go. Another harvest. So, filling. So this has the 16s mostly here, and then the 17s are going in lower barrels. When I bottle the 16s in between May and August, I'll empty out the lower barrel room, and then the 18s will go in the lower barrel room. Sorry, 17s down here, 16s will empty out, 18s will go back. So I can hold about 190 each lower barrels. Sort of a mess right now. I do about 22 months on average, barrel aging. I would go longer, but it would just pick up more and more and more costs, and then I can't sell it. But I'm going to show you what some extended aging can do with a barrel. The beauty of a barrel is, sure, you get some of this influence from the barrel itself, particularly if it's a brand new barrel. Like the Chardonnay sees 100% new French oak. Everything else sees between 10 and 20% new oak. But this is sort of my trial. This is how I try new barrels, decide whether I like them. I do two of this guy, I do that. Notice every two are different. It just gives me a glimpse. Chardonnay is very malleable. You know, it's sort of a blank slate. So it makes a perfect try. Now, it sounds like a lot of oak for one wine, and it's somewhat, it's counterintuitive. After about two years, it doesn't become more oaky, it becomes better integrated, more nuanced. So this is very much in the raw. By the time we're finished, this will get some acid, it will get fine. But shown very well this early on. Now the oak isn't hiding, but I think you'll find it very well. So this is very different than all the other whites we make. All the other whites are 100% stainless and don't see a barrel. They do not go through the secondary fermentation, the malolactic fermentation, which softens the acid profile because the bacteria that I'm adding are consuming the metabolizing the malic acid, it's lactic acid, which really doesn't affect the acid profile. Malic acid is sort of that pathway type of acid. Green, think green apple.
Thank you. Yeah.